Let's move on to a new topic that we're promptly going to forget. This is called joins. So this is a type of SQL query that you can use that involves multiple tables. Remember we had our link table. We've been working with that this entire lecture. It looks something like this. It's got the columns, you know, ID and votes and the user ID who submitted it, you know, data, title, URL. So let's make up some values for these. Now, what I want to talk about right now is this user ID column. Remember I mentioned before that if we had another table called users that looks something like this, you know, it's got a column for ID and a column for name and password and date. The user ID in the links table refers to the ID column of the user table. This should always match up because, you know, you want everything in your system to be, you know, consistent, you know. So for every unique user ID in the links table, there should be a valid user in the user table. Now, one of the things we can do in most SQL databases is something called a join, which is a SQL statement that involves two tables. So we have a basic SQL statement that looks something like this. So select from the link table where user ID equals 22. And so that would return all of the links submitted by this user, you know, assuming there's more than one. Now, what if we didn't know the user's ID? What if instead we wanted to select from the link table all of the links submitted by users with the name Spez? Well, there's a couple ways you could do that. You could first do a lookup for, you know, what is the user ID of the person named Spez, you know, grab this user ID, and then run this SQL query. So you could do two queries. It might look something like this. So I could run one query to get the ID from the user table for the user whose name equals Spez, and then we can use that ID in a second query. But there's another way of doing this query. I could, instead of running two queries, combine this into one query. So instead of from link, we can change this to link comma user, which will scan both tables. And we don't want to get all of the attributes. We want to preserve the same results from the query. So we don't want to select star from link and user. We want to select link.star, which will return just the columns from the link table. And then we want to change our where clause to link these two tables. So where user underscore ID equals user dot ID, I could have also said link.user underscore ID, so we include the table names and all of our properties. That'll make things more clear. I need to add another clause to this. And user.name equals Spez. So what does this do? Select all of the columns from link, link.star, from the link table and the user table, where user.name equals Spez and link.userid equals user.id. And what this does is what's called a join query. And your SQL engine will decide which of these tables to scan first. And in this case, it'll probably do the user table first. So it'll find the username Spez. And then it'll find all the links whose user underscore ID property matches the ID field in the user table. So this is a handy thing. Now, the reason I said we're going to learn something that we're promptly going to forget is because we don't use joins very often when writing web software. You know, it's something you'll see in almost every SQL tutorial, but for reasons we'll explain later in this lecture, joins don't work very well for the types of problems we're going to be solving writing web stuff. But you should be familiar with them. You should know what they are, and you know, you may be writing something that requires this. But you know, they're often, well, as I said, we'll get into this later in the lecture why we don't want to use joins. Let's move on to something new.